to talk to you about targeting cytokines. And if you talk about SGIA, you have heard a lot about targeting IL-1 and IL-6. And the first things I want to simply say is that you actually do not eliminate completely the risk of MAS, even in patients in which IL-1 and IL-6 are inhibited. This is the rate of probable or definitive MAS adjudicated events in the two development program of canakinumab tocilizumab. And you see that the incidence rate is still pretty evident there. What about IL-1 inhibitions? There is evidence of efficacy of anakinra in at least some cases of patients with MAS. You have to use high dose. There is some evidence of resolution of MAS on high dose canakinumab, but there is also the opposite, case reports of MAS reported as triggered, dotted and question marked by anakinra. I think this is simply patients that were treated with anakinra that developed MAS because the disease was not sufficiently controlled. I don't think that anakinra can trigger MAS, certainly. And the same is somehow true with IL-6. There are some responses of good response, and certainly the cytokine storm that follows belimumab treatment or CAR T-cell therapy is known to respond satisfactorily in several patients to tocilizumab, to IL-6 inhibition. Nevertheless, from what Alexi told you, it's pretty clear that two targets are becoming targetable in MAS and in general in HLH, one being IL-18. Now, IL-18 is produced by a number of cell types, not only in the immune system. It's produced through an inflammasome, essentially through caspase 1, which cleave an immature precursor, pro-IL-1 beta, into a mature secretable interleukin-18, who is secreted outside of the cell. Now, there are two peculiarities about IL-18. One, that was mentioned by Alexi, there is an inhibitor, actually was mentioned by Bass. There is an inhibitor of IL-18, which is a natural inhibitor, is an IL-18 binding protein, binds IL-18, and IL-18 bound to IL-18 binding protein does not bound the receptor. So this is a natural inhibitor. The second peculiar feature, general feature of IL-18, and that IL-18 does very little by itself. It needs is a cofactor for a number of activity in the immune system and outside of the immune system, not listed here, in the presence of other cytokines. The reason listed here, the reason being that the beta chain of the receptor, it's not usually expressed, but is inducible by the following cytokines that you actually find listed here as cofactor of the effect of interleukin-18. Now, interleukin-18 is targetable, yes it is, using IL-18 binding protein, which is becoming a drug. It's called tadekinig, or IL-18 BPs, and has been used in this study to treat adult onset still disease with the idea outlined with the rationale of the high levels of interleukin-18 being present in patients with SGIA and still disease. And although the primary outcome of this phase 2 study was improvement of joint count by only 20% and a CRP reduction by more than 70%, only 40% of the patient, 40 to 50% of the patient achieved this primary outcome. This is not what we are used to see with IL-1 or IL-6 inhibition in SGIA or in still disease. Therefore, suggesting that indeed the target is not chronic inflammation, the target is interfering with MAS or HLH. And this is data from a paper that I believe this data was shown to you by Scott Canna earlier today, showing that IL-18 levels are particularly increased in patients with MAS, in a number of patients with secondary infection-associated HLH, but not particularly increased in patients with primary familial HLH. And indeed, interleukin-18 appear to predispose to HLH. This is pretty clear in mice. This is IL-18 transgenic mice that have very high level of total IL-18. They have a free IL-18 not bound to IL-18 binding protein. They're fine unless they're triggered with an innate immune stimuli like toll-like receptor 9 stimulation, and these mice do develop severe MAS features. This is also true in the reverse experiment. IL-6 binding protein knockout mice have free IL-18 because they lack IL-18 binding protein, the natural inhibitor. They're fine unless they get triggered, again, toll-like receptor 9 stimulation in this paper, and they do develop severe MAS features. So the data in mice are actually consistent with what we have observed we and others, several people, have observed in patients with autoinflammatory disease associated with high level of interleukin-18, patient with systemic JIA, CDC42-associated, NRC4-associated disease, or CIP, have very high level, chronically elevated level of interleukin-18, but they do not have MAS all the time. There is the need for a trigger, and this is very consistent with the role of IL-18 as a co-stimulator, a cofactor for triggering immune cells, particularly the production of interferon gamma. IL-18 binding protein has been used in two cases. This is a patient with an NRC4-associated disease with recurrent HLH, and once IL-18 binding protein treatment was started, there was a significant decrease in CRP, in ferritin, and the patient did apparently very well. This is again a patient from Alexi, which was reported, I guess, a few weeks ago. A patient with severe persisting systemic JIA and increased recurrent and refractory episode of MAS. And what you can see here that following beginning of IL-18 binding protein, there were MAS episodes. This is platelet counts and thrombocytopenia developed. However, ferritin did not increase. And in general, the MAS severity was significantly reduced. And there was an improvement in linear growth and the ability to wean clinically significant low dose of glucocorticoids. So this is where we are now with inhibiting IL-18 binding protein. We have data showing we have an ongoing trial in patients with NRC4 mutation and XIAP deficiency that is actually enrolling, that is presently enrolling patients. And this is the study I alluded to in adult onset disease, which has been concluded. And no other studies, to the best of my knowledge, are being planned. So Alexia alluded to familial HLH and certainly mentioned to you the role of exaggerated production of interferon gamma in driving the macrophage activation and expansion and the cytokine storm that eventually lead the host to death. And this we have learned from familial HLH, where defective cytotoxicity leads to permanent or persistent CD8 activation with long-lasting contact with the antigen-presenting cell and therefore exaggerated production of interferon gamma. So there is no doubt that genetic defect in cytolytic pathway can lead to increased T-cell expansion and interferon gamma production. And this plays a major role in the creation of a vicious loop, Alexia alluded to it, in which macrophage activation and expansion leads to further activation of increased T-cells. And this is due in monogenic patient due to defect in cytotoxicity. However, there are diseases, and certainly NLRC4 or CDC42 disease, as well as probably SJIA, in which genetic or polygenic predisposition to macrophage hyperresponsive with increased production of IL-18 does induce the same vicious circle with overproduction of interferon gamma that apparently may be the common mediator. And this is indeed the case, at least in mice. These are a number of models, a murine model, of primary or secondary HLH due to infection, essentially, or mimicker of infection in mice which have been transgenic, genetically modified or wild type. In all these mice, there is increased production of interferon gamma, and when tested, the neutralization of interferon gamma was beneficial in the mice. So this was translated into two clinical trials that are, this is concluded in primary HLH, which is led by Franco Locatelli and Michael Jordan. This trial, to make a long story short, started as a second line trial in patients who have previously failed traditional treatment for primary HLH, which are listed here. These patients, to make a long story short, did pretty well. The overall survival in the population was around 70%. Consider that in HLH-204, the overall survival is approximately 50% in first-line patient, not second-line patient, who had previously failed conventional therapy. Post-BMT, the survival is close to 90%. This data led to approval of the drug and also to another finding. You have heard about CXCL9 as a marker of interferon gamma. I think Scott told you about this. And indeed, you can use CXCL9 as a marker of neutralization of interferon gamma bioactivity. When you start treatment in patients with primary HLH, very quickly CXCL9 level drop down to normal in a matter of a few days. So based on this data, emapalumab is approved. This is the label of emapalumab in the US, was approved by the FDA, and I think you should refer to this document, which is the multidiscipline review that provides the rationale for approval by the FDA, which I think is a very good document. The paper on the clinical trial data has been submitted. A few years ago, we started looking at CXCL9 in patients with MAS in the course of SJIA. And what you can see here is the increase during MAS, but not during SJIA, active SJIA, and the correlation with ferritin, which is pretty evident during MAS, but not during active SJIA. And this is indeed the case not only for ferritin, but also for a number of traditional MAS parameters showing a relation between activation of interferon gamma pathway as reflected by CXCL9 and severity of MAS. So this is also, it looks like this may also be true, that increased activation of macrophage may possibly through IL18 leads to the same vicious circle that does involve interferon gamma, and that I might support this hypothesis in a couple of MAS models, and therefore a trial is underway. Actually, twin study protocols are underway with emapalumab, the anti-interferon gamma antibody, in North America and in Europe. Each one of the two twin protocols should have recruited 5 patients. In Europe, we recruited 6 already. I'm going to present to you the data of the 6 patients recruited in Europe. So the dosing regimen is with 6 milligrams per kilogram at the first dose, and then 3 milligrams per kilogram every 3 days or twice a week. The drug is administered for 4 weeks, and then the patient is followed up over time. The treatment may be shortened if the patient achieves complete response. I will skip the inclusion criteria for sake of time. I'll show you the baseline demographic and baseline disease feature of these patients. Four of them had confirmed systemic HLH according to the ILA criteria. All of them were receiving high dose methylprednisolone. 4 of them were receiving pulses. 3 of them were receiving cyclosporine A, and 2 of them were receiving anakinra. This is the MAS activity at screening and the standard laboratory values that you can read at screening. At baseline, there are a few days in between in which the patient is receiving this treatment. You see no significant improvement or no significant change in these variables. And this is the story of the study. 6 patients were enrolled. All of them achieved complete response. 5 out of 6 tapered glucocorticoids more than 50%. All are alive, and there were no MAS relapses until the study. This is CXCL9 again. Rapid decrease back to normal of CXCL9 level, demonstrating rapid neutralization of interferon gamma. The primary outcome of the study was complete response, defined as a resolution of clinical sign and symptom as assessed by the investigator and normalization of laboratory parameters relevant to MAS, as shown down here. As I mentioned, 6 out of 6 patients achieved complete response at week 8, and 3 out of 6 achieved complete response at week 4. These are the median values of the 6 patients of the classical parameter. You see ferritin, platelet counts going up, D-dimer going down, LDH going down, and AST going down here. More than the median level, it's nice to see the trend of the individual patient. We use spider graph or spider plots in which the ratio between the value and the normal value, the value according to the patient, is expressed as a log value. So just to make an example, this patient has 5 here as AST is the log value. His value is 1,092. 920 units ml of AST. This is one patient at baseline, and what you see at week four, is essentially all the values getting in between the orange dots area that shows the limit of normal. So essentially no more abnormality at day 28, week four. This is one patient longitudinally, again, a number of abnormalities quickly going into the normal area. Now all the patients at the same time, so this is patient 126, day 0, day 14, day 28, and what you see essentially is the blue area disappearing in within the orange area, showing normalization of all parameters. This is glucocorticoid tapering. This compared is percentage of glucocorticoid tapering compared to the average daily dose during week one of the study. Very little safety-wise. Serious events was a CMV reactivation, considered serious and related. There was one cardiorespiratory failure unrelated during day one of treatment during MAS worsening at the very beginning of the treatment. There were a few infections reported, most of them were accurate. Test positive, one for adeno, one parainfluenza, three CMV PCR, one urinary BK virus, all resolved without treatment. So in conclusion, emapalumab was very efficient, very effective in this patient. All patients achieved a complete response. We now recruited a total of 8 patients. All of them have achieved a complete response. There are also 2 patients who received emapalumab for MAS in SJIA under compassionate use regimen. Both of them achieved complete response. So I think this data suggests that this treatment is very effective. In summary, I think IL-1 and IL-6 targeting does not offer complete protection from MAS in SJIA. There are case reports of response to IL-1 or IL-6 inhibition in some forms. There is certainly a rationale for inhibiting IL-6 as a cofactor in inducing interferon gamma, and the rationale for inhibiting interferon factor. Interferon gamma as the major mediator in several disorders in the context of the HLH-MAS spectrum disorder. We have also treated patients with NRC4 disease and the CDC42 patients I alluded to this morning, and they all responded to interferon gamma neutralization with emapalumab, and emapalumab has been approved for primary HLH. I want to mention the people who in the lab studied the mice model and the sample for the patient, and Claudia Emanuela ran the clinic together with the Novimmune team who is leading the development of emapalumab. Thank you very much.